I hope it will be a very useful session, especially since all of the participants are PhD students, and hope that you will be able to use it. Like, though in this session, I will just introduce you to this topic, and it's not meant to be a final guide or complete guide of what is called as systematic review and meta-analysis, because it is such a vast topic. And there are like weeks of trainings, training programs that is of like 2 weeks, like that kind of things are happening. And we are just doing that in 1.5 hours time. So today I will just help you to see some of the basic concepts of evidence synthesis. And we'll try to practically do a small, very small exercise using RevMan software. Hope you all were able to install that in your system. And if not, don't worry. Like in the later part of the session, when we do that, we'll able to see how it is done. So let's dive into the topic. So if I were asked to put in one sentence about today's lecture, I will rather put it this way. Systematic review, it is a complete exhaustive summary of current literature on a research topic or question. Expanding it further, to answer the question, we are trying to gather all information, filter out all the non-relevant ones, and then combining the relevant information to report the effects of intervention that we are interested in based on existing evidence. We also try to report the research gaps. But mind you, this entire process has to be rigorous, scientific, as well as transparent. So this is the complete outline of today's lecture. So if you are through with this process, yeah, it's fine. Like now then it is the process of like self-learning, as I told. So we all know, being in the research field, lots and lots of papers are being published every day on any topic for that matter. Here I have tried to put an example of how the number of servings of fruits on a single day will help improve the health. So the left, the study which is put on the left hand, that is summarizing that 7 fruit servings a day improves the health. And there are lot of studies which are in this line, which suggest that as the number of fruit servings increases, like as you eat more and more of fruits on in a single day, a proportionate increase in the health is health can be realized. So that is like individual studies, that is what they are reporting. On the study which is put on the right hand side, that is a meta-analysis of several individual studies that has been conducted from different parts of the world, and that has reported that there is no effect of eating more than 5 fruit servings on a single day. So as a decision maker, or as a person who recommends, or the medical team or the government people who like health professionals who recommends that how many fruits should a person eat, they will rely more on the meta-analysis, second study which I mentioned, the meta-analysis kind of thing. That is because it considered more number of samples, or more number of like studies from different locations, and all, in comparison to the earlier study, which is conducted at a particular place using a small number of sample. However, be now high or small be the number of things, there may be other kind of bias that is occurring. So is the case in agriculture. We have a very hot case of contract farming. So there are a lot of evidence that is available from all over the world showing the benefits, advantages, as well as disadvantages of contract farming. So whether contract farming is able to improve the smallholder's income. So how can we depend whether any particular study conducted by any organization, published in any particular journal, shall we rely on any single study to recommend a policy? Or shall we depend on something like this study, which is a meta-analysis that has reported that it has the contract farming has the potential to give like something like 63% improvement in the income. So this particular graph is called as forest plot. So this is our destination for today's lecture. So we are trying to understand the process how on any topic of system, any topic or system of systematic review and meta-analysis, we will be finally reaching to this position where we are able to pull the results of several individual studies into a single effect size, which is reliable and which we can recommend to the stakeholders. So evidence synthesis is the process of finding and combining the results of multiple primary studies addressing the same research question. So that is a process. And more importantly, as Deshpande sir told, it should improve the current state of knowledge. Either it should like support the current evidences or it should refute. And whatever the result be, it should improve the current knowledge level. That's what the process does. And systematic review and meta-analysis are just tools of evidence synthesis, but these are gold standards. Why these are gold standards? Because individual studies have several bias in terms of like maybe that bias even you people also may be having within your mind when you do analysis and get a result. Something which gives you a significant positive result, you are happy and you feel that your paper has got more chance of getting accepted than some negative result coming, non-significant result coming. At that time, you will be rather disappointed why it is not coming significant, why it is coming not significant. But in fact, that is called as the bias. Both are results, even non-significant result means that is also a result. So that kind of bias exists and there are more chances of positive results getting published. So individual, that kind of bias we try to control while doing the evidence synthesis process using systematic review and meta-analysis. So in the landscape of reviews, where we keep this? So we all know traditional kind of reviews, maybe narrative review, some kind of things where we have an idea about like how what will be the subheadings or how we'll be approaching a topic. And we try to search for papers or articles available to support our subheadings or our proposition. Yeah. And we'll, yeah, all fine? Okay, I think there was some voice. So let me continue. Hello. So we have this traditional review, as I told, it is just we search some papers and we put it as per our proposition. But systematic reviews are like one step higher than the traditional kind of reviews, where the entire process is systematic. There is a procedure by which we arrive at the literature that we finally select to be included in our review. And meta-analysis is a statistical technique of combining the effect sizes. Means like meta-analysis follows the systematic review and it helps us to statistically combine the effects available from each individual study to a final effect size. So systematic review can also be followed by vote counting can also be used after doing the systematic review. In vote counting, what we do is that how many number of studies are stating that an intervention improved the income or improved the like whatever be the effect that we are measuring, and how many studies opposed that finding, and we are reporting that. That is called as vote counting. So relationship between systematic review and meta-analysis is that meta-analysis is what we are doing after the systematic review procedure. So all meta-analysis involves systematic review in this, but it's not necessary that all systematic review should be followed by a meta-analysis. But meta-analysis, if you have to do, you definitely have to do complete the systematic review procedure. Hope it is clear. So now let's see what are the different steps in the systematic review. Setting the question, yes, we need a research question based on which we are formulating our strategy of collecting the literature. Yeah. So we set the question first, which is based on PICO. I will explain that term further. PICO stands for population, intervention, control, and outcome. Then we do the searching, then we screen and remove the non-relevant studies. We code to extract the data from the selected studies, and then we synthesize and report. Also, when we do, before we start a systematic review procedure, we also need to take care of a few things like theory of change and protocol. Theory of change is that what is the way in which the intervention that we are going to measure is going to affect the population, and what are the other variables that could also influence. For example, if we are studying the effect of a technology, so how the technology will improve the outcome, means income or crop yield, and what are the other socioeconomic variables that can also, socioeconomic or biophysical or whatever variables, that we need to like hypothesize the flow. And also we need to prepare a protocol. Protocol, as we know in biological sciences, for preparing solutions and mediums, they have a specific protocol. Like you have to use 5 ml of this chemical and 10 ml of this chemical. That is so specific. If 1 or 2 ml here and there, the entire the output will be becoming something else. So like that. So before we start a systematic review, we have to make a protocol which contains all the information about how we proceed, how we start, how we go through it, and how we end the process. Like what is the purpose? What is the research question? What are the keywords using which we will be searching the data? Then what are the databases? And what will be the inclusion criteria? What are the outcome variables? Everything has to be written. And there are several organizations where we can submit these protocols, and they have high quality reviewers who are very, very much who have very much expertise in these systematic review and meta-analysis procedures. They guide you. They help us to improve the thing. And once they accept, it is as good as our final paper getting published in very good journal. Something like Cochrane review, Cochrane, Campbell and Cochrane collaboration, they accept that. For non-Cochrane also, there are some repositories where we can do in well these facilities. Another important thing which we need to address at the first stage itself is like, what can be the scope? Like how large or how narrow should our research question be? So here I have tried to put on the right side the some of the questions, and we can by reading itself you will be able to understand so which one is most suited. So do farmer field schools work? That is the broadest question available about farmer field schools. So we need to create data from all over the world for that. So that may be too much of data to compare, and don't know how far we'll be able to bring with a concrete result to give any policy suggestion. Do farmer field schools work in the Karnal district of Haryana? It is too specific. We may not even get more than 2-3 studies on those. So that is also not suitable. But something like the third one may be right. Farmer field schools for improving farming practices and farmer outcomes in low and middle income countries, a systematic review. This can be a good research question or good topic of for starting a systematic review. So how to start the process, first step is setting the question. As I told, we have to be very clear with population, intervention, comparison, and outcome. So population means who are the stakeholders, whether it is the farmers or in the medical things, like who are our subject of study. And then intervention, what is the technology, and comparison, to whom does we compare, and outcome, what we are measuring. So this has to be very much clear. Okay, this I have told what is a population and what are intervention. These are some of the examples that you can go through it. Interventions like discovery-based learning approach, integrated pest management, intervention like integrated soil nutrient management, etc. And you can definitely think from your own research areas whether what can be called as an intervention. Comparison, of course, these are the communities or the people who are not getting the intervention. For example, if it is farmers training, the farmers from the locality who are not trained, that is comparison. Outcome, there can be outcome in different levels, like agricultural outcomes in terms of yield, net revenue, income, empowerment. These are the things that we are measuring. Finally, we will, at the end of the meta-analysis, systematic review and meta-analysis, we will be getting in the result in terms of the outcome, like how much improvement in the yield has been occurred as a result of a particular intervention. So from several studies, we are arriving at a single value so that it becomes more reliable. The second point in the process is searching. So how can we arrive at the correct number of, not only the number, the right set of literature, right population of papers or right set of papers that from which we have to extract the data. So we are looking for quality primary studies. And the idea is that we should not leave any of the literature untouched, on the topic untouched. For example, if we are conducting literature on any topic for the period 2010 to 20 on a particular topic, our search strategy should be set such that not a single article published or not published should be left out of it. So our idea should be that, and we should work hard to achieve that. Not only the published, even systematic review and literature meta-analysis necessitates to look for gray literature, which at times are not the literature that is not published in research articles. It may be as policy briefs, or it may be even as published in the websites of different organizations. And even we should look to see, contact the office, and we should look to see the hard copies if evidences are available in that also. The idea is that we should not leave anything untouched. Then only our final output will have value. We should not do, for our convenience, we are selecting in Google Scholar if we search and get 500 papers and okay, this is enough. We should not decide in just for the sake of our convenience. So then there is no meaning of doing the entire procedure. There are several databases from which the literature can be searched. We all know Web of Science, Scopus, Google Scholar, there are SERA, I think like most of our organized agricultural universities have access to. There is something called as AJCon search and lot more. Lot many databases are there. So it is necessary in a systematic review and meta-analysis to collect literature from more than one database. So depending on a single database will not serve our purpose. And then what can be the search strategy? How we can decide? For example, if our topic of interest is farmer field school, I have given in tables while searching what will be the results in Google Scholar and Eric. These are two databases. So we basically use Boolean operators, which is and, or, not, those kind of things. And also we can make use of asterisks, quotation. This search strategy itself is a separate class. So I think better you go read from internet or any other books on searching literature. It is plenty of it is available. So just have a look on the table to get how we can narrow down to a specific thing. So just even we give farmer field school, we are getting more than 11 lakhs articles on that. The problem is that in those there will be papers which is based on farmers and field and school. Those will be separate. Not necessarily it is, it may not be necessary of farmer field school. For that we have to put those in the quotation mark. Then there is another strategy is if we are fixing a time period, then we can get do it like that. Since 2011, for example, then Africa and Asia, and Africa, Asia, put those in brackets. So use these Boolean operators to narrow down to this set of literature that is very specific to our topic of interest. So once we finally arrive at the entire number of papers that we have got, then we have to screen it. Screening means like individually you have to go to, for example, the flowchart that is given, that is called as Prisma flowchart. This is very important for systematic review and meta-analysis in the sense that we need to submit this to journals when we send it for publication. So using the search words which we have reporting and searching in the same databases, same number of papers should appear. So otherwise there is no validity of what we are doing. So from 2000 records here given, which is identified initially from the databases, the authors have narrowed down to 18 based on first by removing the duplicate references, then title screening, then abstract screening, and then full text reviewing. So finally, after full text reviewing and to looking, the authors will look for whether the papers meet our inclusion criteria. So the paper inclusion criteria and exclusion criteria, we have to specifically fix at the time of doing our protocol. So studies which does not meet the relevant design, anything like studies which does not report the necessary things cannot be taken for meta-analysis. The studies that are not of good quality, like so we have to fix the inclusion criteria basically, and whatever things which are not meeting, we have to report that these many number of studies are excluded since due to these things. Okay. So in this way, we finally arrive at the number of studies. I have just given a screenshot of how we select the study. So farmer field schools and impact, for example, if that is the search word, and in Google Scholar, these and this number of papers are coming. So let's just go through the first, sending farmers back to school, the impact of farmer field school. Yes, we have to select that. The impact of farmer field schools in knowledge, second paper that, yes, it is selected. Third one is also selected. Fourth one, issues for agricultural extension policy in Nigeria. From title screening, it is not sure that whether it has to be included. So if not sure, we have to go for abstract reading. And after reading abstract reading, if we find that it is not a paper which is dealing with our interest, we can remove that. Or at that stage itself, if it is not clear, we have to go through the entire paper and decide whether we have to include or exclude. To help in this process, there are different softwares available. This Ryan is one which is available. There may be other you have to go, but basically these are just to support, help our process. We have to trust ourselves for in this. We have to individually go through all the studies to get a good set of final study, final set of literature. Okay. So this is also just an example of the number of how authors have arrived from a large number of studies to a specific very less number of studies that has met all the inclusion criteria, and the search string is also given on the left. So a lot of papers are available on systematic review and meta-analysis on internet. You just go through it and it will be clear from that. So once we arrive at the final set of papers, once we select our papers for doing systematic review, we have to then code and extract the data from each of the paper. Coding and data extraction means while we have to individually go through the entire paper and collect all the information from each of the final set of papers. The reading of that paper should be such a way that it should not necessitate us to look back again. We should go through each sentence to look for any information. And all the information can be collected and entered on Excel sheet or Outlook things or any, like anything of convenience. But of course, different papers report things in different way, and all the information will not be uniform. But that can be that can be done at the later stage, which all variables we will be keeping or which all variables we will be removing, that we will be doing at the later stage. But idea is that we have to extract all the information which is available, and some information which, if it is not available, we even have to contact the authors and try to collect the information. That is the procedure. This is just an example of how coding can be done. This can be the some of the entries on the Excel sheet, like how to identify a study, paper number or study number you can give, then the author name, year of the study, the journal, then the research method used, what is the effect size measured. This is just an example. Okay, so depending on your set of papers, you have to make the coding sheet accordingly. So finally, we have extracted the data and we are arriving at the final step of systematic review, in which, so now we have the data from all the final set of papers, then we report the findings. Like we can identify indicators and explain that this many number of papers from the final set, they have reported that there is an increase in income, and this many number of papers have reported that there is an yield improvement, or whatever be the, we can specifically identify some of the indicators, then report everything accordingly for different regions, for different agroclimatic zones, association between different, how many studies have told that with increase in the subsidy, and how much has the fertilizer consumption increased, something like that. So entire thing, we are just presenting qualitatively information in matrix form or tabular form. So there ends the systematic review procedure. So following which, as I told, comes the meta-analysis, which is the statistical way of arriving at the pooled effects. So I told that there may be different kinds of errors or bias when it comes to individual studies. So some things like type 2 error, when the individual studies are not reporting a significant effect, because of, in actually that effect may be there, but due to the smaller sample size, that effect is not, we are not able to capture, means that the authors are not able to capture. So we try to take care of both these things, the false negative effect as well as the false positive effect, the positive effect, which is, though there is positive effect, sometimes it will be so minute that it does not have any practical relevance. So both the kind of things we are taking into consideration in meta-analysis. So the meta-analysis simply is an average of the effects found by the individual studies. We are taking the average of all the effects which we have got from all the individual studies. But it is a weighted average, and the weight is based on the variance of the study. For example, the studies with the more number of samples, that will be having less variance, and less variance means that will get more weightage in the final pooling procedure, final meta-analysis thing. Okay, so studies with more number of samples will be getting more weightage, obviously, because they have a smaller confidence interval. So look at this forest plot. So in this forest plot, there is a central line, middle line, which is denotes the zero value, and right side it is positive effect, and left side it is negative effect. So the small square, or rather that black colored diamond shape, which is visible against the individual studies, that is giving the individual effect size for how, what are, what is the individual effect that is found out by the each study. That gray square, that gives the weight of the study, how much weight each study has gained. So you can just cross check with the, like, the larger, against the larger square, gray squares, you can just cross check how much is the value of weight and how narrow is their confidence intervals. In the, against the smaller gray squares, you can see that their confidence intervals are very large. Okay, so in that way, quality studies are getting more weightage. That is the only thing. And towards the end, on the downside, we get the overall effect size also, which gives from all the studies, what is the effect size? What it is, a pooled effect size. So in pooling, we can do it. There are two approaches, fixed effect model as well as random effect model. So in fixed effect model, it assumes that all the studies in meta-analysis share a common effect size. This means that just look into the figure, don't get confused. It assumes that the triangle on the downside is the overall true effect. Okay, so the fixed effect model assumes that the true effect of all the individual studies are same as the true effect of the overall true effect. So we are just measuring the true effect, which is same in all the cases, and the observed effect is definitely varying from that, but except this variation is only due to the number of samples or the sampling error. Okay, that is what is called, what is the concept in fixed effect model. But in reality, it may not be the case. So in most of the cases, we are safe to you. We will be safer if we use the random effects model, because we know that it is not only the true effects may not be the same in all the cases. And there may be several covariates or factors that we are not measuring. So the true effect will be looking something like this, as in the case of random effects. The true effect itself of individual studies itself is not on the same line as the overall true effect. Okay, so even if we increase the sample size to infinity, we will be reaching at the true effect, which is not the overall true effect. So we have to take care of this bias. Just understand that in most of the cases, random effects model is safer to use, because there are many factors which we are not measuring. Okay. So fixed effects model assume that there is only one effect size to be discovered. Random effects model assume that effect sizes will differ depending on the type of study, population, implementation, project type, etc. And of course, in social science, this is definitely the case. So we measure the heterogeneity and we present it along with our pooled effect size. That's what we do in meta-analysis. And how we are measuring the heterogeneity, there are different estimates. I-square and tau-square, those are the few things which we get directly from the softwares. I-square. I-square value, this gives like something around, lower the I-square value, less heterogeneous the results. So like something I-square value, if we are getting some more than like 80 and 90, the results, we have to report that there is considerable amount of heterogeneity in our results. Okay. Then we can explain that heterogeneity further using moderator analysis and meta-regression. So what we are doing, we'll be getting the effect size for all the individual studies. So we are regressing those effect sizes using all the individual, several other factors or covariates that can affect these effect sizes. And we can explain that due to increase in soil pH, the yield, the effect of this kind of fertilizer has decreased by this percent. So those kind of relationships can be explained. So using moderator analysis and meta regression. So effect size, I have been telling about this effect size. Hope it is clear. Are everyone clear till this? So I think I'm giving several new terms and all of you are with me. Say yes by unmuting at least one or two so that I can just yes, proceed. Sir. Yeah. So yes, you have. Okay. Yes, we can, okay. Thank you. So we can go yes, ahead sir. And we can clarify doubts on the later part if you have any. Okay. So as I told, effect size is what we are measuring, the measurement of the outcome. Okay. So we can use different things. The commonly used effect size are mean difference. For example, if we are measuring continuous variables, if we are measuring the impact of an intervention on income, yield, or weight, or whatever, like quantity, which is a continuous variable, we are safe to use mean difference or standardized mean difference. So to measure this mean difference, what we need is that from each study which we have selected to the final set, we have to extract the mean of the treatment and mean of the control. That is what is required for mean difference. So mean value of the treatment and number of, obviously we have already collected all the information. So from how many people the data is collected, or how many number of replication, all the things we have collected. So for continuous variables, we can use mean difference. And another thing which we can use for continuous variable is standardized mean difference. So in standardized mean difference, we make use of also the standard deviation, which is reported in individual studies. So standardized mean difference is preferred more. But while using standardized mean difference, the outcome final pooled effect size cannot be interpreted directly as mean difference is this much. We have to back convert the standardized mean difference to mean difference. Yes, that I will be explaining in the next stage. But these two are the example for effect. There are many effect sizes. So I'm just giving you a few things. These two can be used in continuous variables. So the third one is like ratios, response ratio, risk ratio, like that. So usually, for example, very commonly used in medicine, in the sense like the systematic review and meta-analysis itself has greatest utility in medical field. So how these ratios are used as effect size? If, for example, 1,000 people are given a medicine and like 100 out of them reported positive, like they the disease, severity of the disease has reduced. So in that case, like 100 by 1,000, that can be taken as the ratio, something like that. Out of total people who has received treatment, how many have responded? So in that way, that is the ratio. At times, we can also see papers which take the yield of treated and yield of control, like the continuous variable, it's also they use this. But ideally for continuous variable, we should use mean difference and standardized mean difference. Okay, there may be many other effect sizes like correlation coefficients and all. So this I have already told. These two are preferred when we use continuous variable as the effect size. So if we are using standardized mean difference, we have to estimate pooled standard deviation using this formula. Simply, this formula requires the standard deviation from individual studies as well as the sample size or the number of replications or whatever be the thing, sample n. Okay, and then only we have to back convert the standardized mean difference to mean difference to estimate, present the result in a readily interpretable way. Okay, so this also I have told, the ratio effect size where it is used maximum, response ratio as I told, sometimes log of response ratio is also used. You can just search for some of the papers and read how they are using the effect sizes. Okay, so another important thing is that along now we have got the pooled effect size, okay, but also we have to report the bias which is present in individual studies. So what kind of bias is there? We have to go that this decision is ours. Like while reading the paper, we found that in this paper there is replication bias or experiment duration bias, or what are the things that is lacking in these papers. Okay, so that has to be presented, and the right side of the graph which is given on the right side is called as funnel plot. Funnel plot and Eggers test I have not given, but I will tell what it is. So it regresses, Eggers test regresses our effect size with standard error, and this funnel plot is plotting that. So just you need to understand that the individual studies are the thing means are depicted on that graph, and it should look symmetrically, like on both sides almost. If symmetry is there, we can claim that there is no bias in the papers that we have selected. But if, for example, in this case we are seeing that it is slightly biased towards right side, that means there is a publication bias towards the positive effect of the intervention. So ideally it should be scattered all over uniformly or like almost asymmetry. Just by visual examination we should be able to feel that. Okay, so this also we have to report along with the individual results. So that's what I wanted to tell you basically on this systematic review and meta analysis. And now I also I request you to just think of some of the topics that can be taken for doing systematic review and meta analysis based on your field. These are some of the examples you can think of your own. Also, you should look, just type in Google Prisma and it will take you to a website. So there you will be able to download this sheet. This is not the end, there are two pages. So this is called as Prisma checklist. So when you complete a meta-analysis and systematic review and submit a paper, the journals will ask for this Prisma checklist also. Most of the quality journals, they will ask for Prisma checklist. So you have to report all the things. What is the title, structured summary, rationale, protocol registration, if you have registered, eligibility criteria, means what is the inclusion strategy, inclusion criteria, what are the search criteria, everything we have to report. And if because this otherwise it will be difficult for the reviewers to follow what you have done. Okay, so this is what I wanted to explain basically on the procedure. And now I think let us do a small exercise on this meta-analysis using the RevMan software. Okay, but before that, I like if you have like 5 minutes, I will take listen to some of your questions or doubts if you have any, and then we can go for the exercise. You can unmute and do it. You can unmute and ask. Yeah, everyone clear?
Hello, good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening.
Sir, yeah, can we check any topic in this Prisma?
Sorry, please repeat it once again.
Can we check any topic in the Prisma checklist?
No. It is not for checking. Actually, this we have to enter this while we're downloading. It will be blank. Only the section or topic will be there, and we have to enter the thing. It's not that this is not a repository. Prisma is a what guideline. You have to follow guidelines as you told. Okay, means like prisma flow chart. I will show. This is the prisma flow chart, and this is what we are reporting in the paper, which I mean in the final slide that I have shown. What, how we have arrived at the final state, final number of paper. So for there is no website to search for a topic on systematic review and meta-analysis. That you have to decide on your own whether the, your research question is suitable for systematic review or meta-analysis. For that, you have to like read on the literature, just see how these studies are formulated. Yes, and as I told, you have to keep in mind the scope and whether there is a good intervention to these studies, whether, as I told, it should improve the knowledge, the current level of knowledge. So what we are studying, it should improve the current state of knowledge. So, and there should be a treatment control. So all these things have to be there for a topic to be selected. So any others?
Hello, sir.
Hello.
How does the Ryan software exactly help you in screening articles?
Yeah, as I told, Ryan, in fact, I also have not used, but I know that it is a software that helps us to helps us in sorting the papers from the databases. So we can add from, for example, from Google Scholar or Web of Science, we can select individual study and put in that software. And in different, you can give labels and arrange uniform studies in different sets like that. So I request you to go through the individual study. But as I told, it's it's just a helping tool. You have to, most of the things you have to do manually. And ideally, systematic review involves participation of more than a single author and screen, especially in steps like screening and excluding papers. The authors have to do it separately, and they have to finally check whether both the authors or all the authors have excluded the same set of papers, or if not, why has it happened, whether there is any bias from the author's side, and then arrive at the final set. Okay. Yeah. Any others? Okay, so shall we go for the exercise? Hope all of you have installed RevMan.
Yes, sir.
Anybody having problem in installing that?
No, sir.
I hope it is not. So, just a second. I'll do one thing. I will first do a small exercise. You can just sit back and see what is happening, and then I will direct you how to do on your own. Okay, for the first step. Stage, you just see what is happening. Is my RevMan window visible to you, or I'm still on the slide?
No, sir, it is not visible.
Just a second, I have to stop my screen sharing. Yeah, now it is visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so this is how it looks when we open the RevMan software. So to start, we have to go to the file menu. We have to click on the new. There comes a new review wizard. We have to click on next. There are different types of reviews, and we have to select intervention review, basically since we are interested in studying the effect of an intervention. Then we can give a title if we wish to show the effect of number of days of training on the farmers income. For example, this is just an example which I'm giving. So then click next, then select the full review and you have to finish. So then a window like this will come with a title, the number of days of whatever title you are giving for whatever is the intervention and what we are, any title of your choice. Then a lot of things are coming on the left side window where we have to first select on the studies and references. We have to click on that. And just a second. We have to click on the reference of studies and include studies. So you'll be getting included studies here on the main window. Hope all of you are following. So right click there. There will be an option to add study. Okay. So here, for example, finally, you have arrived at some study like I'm just giving a number 01 and Sanket 2021. If, for example, this is the identification of the study, I can just finish. So
it is Ravi,
Yeah,
I think students are requesting to repeat from the start ones.
Okay, no problem. Just sit back and relax. I will, you all will be doing if you have Redmine installed. I will just quickly do it once and so that you will get used to the window and I will direct step by step. We have time till 7:50. So I will direct you step by step and you are actually doing. Okay, so don't worry when if you have missed the first step. Okay, so just see, there is no need to do on your own now. That's what I have told. Okay. Hope it is okay. So add, we can add more studies. Click on the include study again. Then right click 02 and add the 2020. Again, we can do finish. So both the studies that have appeared here, we can add one more study. 03 Dennis 2019. Yeah. So for example, we have arrived at the only three papers in the final set. This is just an example. There will not be any case in which only the final set is having three papers. Definitely a lot more papers will be there. So now what we have to do is that we have to add the data for these studies. Okay. So that you have to click on the data and analysis, which is coming here. You have to right click on the data and analysis and there will be an option called add comparison. Click on that. So what we are comparing. So what was the title that we have given? Effect on income. Okay. Effect on income. Okay. So if you click next, otherwise we can just finish it here so that that will appear here, the effect on income. Okay. So even if, when we click on the data and analysis, the effect on income, that option is also visible. Then we can double click on that. We can group the, let's say the labels. Control and all, otherwise just a second, we can. It's better to add outcome first. So right click there, you will be adding an outcome, which is farmer's income, which is a continuous variable. You have to click on that. That is income is the outcome. Group one label is experimental. Okay, treated farmer or trained farmer. Trained farmer. And control is the okay others. So we can click on the next. So this window will come. Inverse variance is the process, as I told. The studies with lesser variance are getting the more weightage. And I, as I told, we can select the random effects model, and we can select standardized mean difference or mean difference depending on the our choice. So I select here mean difference for entering it easily, and we can click on next. These are the confidence means at what certainty we are measuring. Yes, we have to click here. So in forest plot, what, how it should appear. On the left side, it is authors, and on the right side, it is trained. Okay. So here sort by year or anything means study ID, that is fine. So when we click next, what we want to do next? Add study data for the new outcome. Then we are continuing. So we are able to see all the three studies that we have selected, and select all of them and finish. So here another window comes where we have got the option to add the data. So here it is the mean income that we have to enter. For example, of the mean income of the trained farmer, if it is 1,000 rupees for a week or month or whatever. This is just, I'm entering a very random thing. And if, for example, 10 is the standard deviation, and we are measuring this from, the authors have measured, that paper have measured this based on data from 150 farmers. And for example, if the control, they have got the mean value is this, and the standard deviation is this, and they have measured using 125. Let me just fill in using some data. So if, for example, if this is the case, so automatically while entering itself, our forest plot will be visible. Don't worry if it is not coming to, we can adjust here. So this is too broad to visualize. This is what we are getting from the, since this is a very hypothetical data, very crude. All of them have got almost equal weightage, and this is the final effect size. To view it in the forest plot way, if we click on the forest plot, this is the final thing that we can save and report on the papers. So the final effect size is like the difference between the treated and control. The income difference is 233 rupees. Okay. And this is, in fact, since, like, for example, zero is coming in between these two confidence intervals, and this effect is not significant. So ideally, if zero is not coming, that automatically, zero is not coming in between the confidence interval, that becomes automatically significant. Okay, so this is how we arrive at the forest plot. Okay, so shall we do a small exercise? Let me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have stopped sharing that. So here, steps I have written for. Let me share again. Yeah. I have written the steps for doing the exercise in the Riffman software here. So just go through it step by step and do it exactly the way it is written. So all of you first open Riffman software. Anybody having trouble at any stage, please tell. So hope everyone have opened. Then go, means one small window may have come, close that and open the, go to the file and click new. It will be good if you can switch on your videos also. at least since it is an exercise, I will also be getting to know whether all of you are happy with how things are going. Don't worry, this step will be with you, this slides will be with you. You can, if at any one stage you are getting blocked, this is a software and you have installed that software now, and always you can just redo again and again and finalize the thing. Okay, so you have clicked new, click then next, then it will prompt for type of review. Select the intervention review there and click next. So all good. All are able to do, I hope. Then you can, yes, anybody having trouble? Okay, so title of the review, you may give any title, it doesn't matter, or leave it blank as well, doesn't matter, anything. Okay, then click next. Then we are at the step 6, where we will be selecting the full review and finishing. Yeah. Done. Okay. So now, as I told, you have to go to the leftmost window and search carefully for the option studies and references. Click that. All good? Who has got problem? So hope all are able to do till that stage. And then right screen included study will be, would have come on the main window, included studies. Research carefully, right click on that and click add study. Yes. Dennis, are you able to do? Yeah. Good. So you have added study.
Can you repeat it, like where to get it?
Are you able to see the studies and references on the left window?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So did you click on that?
Yes, I clicked.
So look for the main window.
Okay.
There will be included studies. Just search. You don't scroll too much down.
Yeah.
You click again on studies and references on the left window. Again, you will be taken to the included studies portion on the window. Yeah. Could you get it? Just look for it. No problem. You have time.
Yes, I got it.
Yeah. Then, right click on included studies and add study. You can give anything study ID. Usually we enter the study number, the author name and the year. That is a standard way. But now for even you can enter ABCD also, just it is the way of identification and just an exercise to save time. So however, so add 2, 3, 4, 5 or 5 studies, like 5, 6 studies. One by one, just add study and finish. Add study and finish. You do that again and again. Two. Fine.
So we have to right click in, click it, and then we have to write.
Yeah. You right click, and then add study. Then you, there will be option to enter the study ID. You can give any name, and finish. Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, the step 3 is not working, sir. I am facing problems.
Step 3.
Intervention.
Welcome to new review wizard. That one. Sorry?
Step 4, sir.
A type of review. Select intervention review.
Yes, sir.
So that option you are not able to select. That's what you are telling.
I have select intervention review.
Okay.
After that, that title one is come, but when I select that next, then full review directly came, sir. That title only is not working. I have to click on full review, sir.
You have to select on full review. Yeah.
But वो next में सर क्लिक नहीं हो रहा है.
Select full review के बाद finish option है. Just do finish.
Okay.
New study wizard में उसमें क्या select करना है, मतलब published data only और unpublished.
Select new wizard में type of review option दिखा रहा है ना. I think type of review is prompted the new wizard. You just select
data source.
Don't select any other thing. Just for this time being, you just select on this. Okay. The type of review. There are I am just showing you at the simplest of the exercise. So that you get it. Means like how the software works. So there are many, many, many other options here. All this bias. This funnel plot, making funnel plot, all these things can be done, but I'm not making things complicated by showing you all these things. So as I told, our journey is till the forest plot. So if you are through with this procedure, then you can explore the software. And there are videos available for RevMan. You can just go to their website and see how things can be done. So using videos, you can side by side do and experience how all these other steps can be done. Okay.
So I'm having problem with under the additional information about studies, number 2.
Number 2?
Yes. For additional information about studies, number 2.
Now we are just adding a study and finishing. Okay, you just go back and finish. You just give the study ID and you have to finish. You just add the study. That's okay.
This is the one. Where should I? I don't know where to put the study ID.
Yeah. Just a second.
Sir, can you tell that first step, sir, left screen, click studies?
Sorry?
Praveen, I think once you can stop screen sharing this slide and show it once.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing now. Stop share. Yeah. So this is the new wizard. As I told, we are selecting the intervention review.
Sir, it is not shared.
Okay, so. Yeah, I hope it is shared.
Yeah.
Okay, let me start from the beginning. So we are starting from here, file. We are doing on new. We are clicking on next, intervention review. We are clicking next. Either we can leave it blank or we can give any title. So I leave it blank here and I click next. I will give full review and I finish. So this is the window that is coming. Now I am looking for these studies and references. Yeah. So I click here and reference to studies comes. I click there. I get included studies. So I click here. I click here on the right side, I get the included study. Okay. So it will take like a 2-3 seconds for this window to appear. So don't worry with that. So included studies are there. So keep cursor there, right click, add study. So this is where we are entering. Usman, I think you were asking that question. This is where we are entering study ID.
Yes, sir, it's coming now.
Yeah, you got it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so the standard format is that we give the number. Like the papers that we are selected already will be given labels in terms of the number, the author name, Singh et al. 2012, for example. Okay, and we just click on finish. So that study has come below the included study. Okay, again, you keep your cursor on the included study, add another one, 02, Dharma 2015, finish. Again, you keep here. Chaudhary 2020, finish. Again, you click here. Yeah, hope you are able to add like at least 3-4 studies there. So now since we have added studies, now we have to add data for individual studies. So search just below the reference to the studies, we have this data and analysis part. Okay. You click on that and right click. You select that and do a right click. Hope it is clear. This data and analysis. Right click, then this add comparison will be prompted. You just click on that. So what we are comparing, for example, yield. If we are comparing yield due to any particular intervention, so just we can type yield. Okay. You just add yield, go back and finish. Okay, so you have added what we are comparing. And now when we click on data and analysis, double click there, yield will be visible. Again, you can add another comparison. For example, along with yield, if you are measuring something else, like the biomass, what we call dry matter weight or dry matter content or something, any other thing. Many outcomes may be measured using from data using from a single study. Okay. So now since we are measuring yield, you click on yield and right click. Not right click, just double click there. What you are. Just a second. Comparison. So in the add outcome option, which variable, what kind of variable we are measuring, that will be there. Okay. So on the yield thing, it seems it is a continuous. Click on that. So everyone did that?
Double click.
So double click. Yeah, you just right click and this on the add outcome. It's a continuous variable. Select the continuous and select next. And since we are measuring yield and experimental and control, let it remain like that. Click on next. We are measuring for inverse variance. That is the method that we are using. Select random effects model. Please mute if someone is not asking question. Okay.
Hello, so, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, on the right side, if we add yield, it's not showing yield option, sir. My name is Megha, sir.
Okay.
On the right side, it is not showing that. Analysis, it's not showing the yield option, sir, even though we have added.
Others, please mute yourself.
Okay, so I think Megha, okay, you are telling that even after adding yield, it is not coming.
Sir, means on the right side, on the main side, it's showing, sir, but on the left, all the list is there, no, sir, there it is not showing. Like below the data and analysis, it's not showing the yield option, sir. There it is showing, sir, where you have put the cursor,
you just
no,
click,
sir.
You just double click on the data and analysis.
Okay, sir.
Did it come?
Yeah, yes, sir, it came, yeah. Sir, thank you.
Okay. So now you right click on that and add outcome and select the option, give that name and just go to next. As I told, you can select random effects model and mean difference and go to next. So let all the options be same here because it is measuring at 95% confidence interval. Yeah, click on next. So hope all of you have come till this stage. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes. Okay, so here, in fact, like in medical research, this software is originally designed for medical field. So there they measure the effect of a medicine. So if a medicine a person is taking and whether what is the, how much is
sorry,
the, like,
sir.
Yeah.
Sorry, sir, for interrupting.
No problem.
Sir, I am on the window, new outcome wizard. Then in name, what needs to add, sir? New outcome wizard. Group level one experimental and group level two control.
Sorry, just a second.
Yes, sir.
You are this one, no? You are in this.
Yes, sir. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Yield. Okay.
Yeah. Yield or something. This is just a name. You just give it some name and click next. Okay. Even without names also, these things will happen. Okay. So you just select random effects and mean difference and click next. And then again, click next. You will be coming to this. So as I told, I think it's okay for you. So just change the label here because for medical field, they are, how much the disease has reduced, that's what they are measuring. So their effects will be towards the left. So here, in our case, this left side of the graph will be control and the right side will be treatment. Okay, treatment effect. So sort by sort ID itself, okay. We are clicking next. And here, option come and everyone carefully see, add steady data for the new outcome. Okay, add steady data for the new outcome and continue. So hope all the steady IDs that you have given entered are visible there for everyone?
Yes, sir. Mine is visible.
Yeah.
Sure.
Good. So select all by just selecting the first one, press the shift key and press the arrow key. You can select everything and then click finish. Yes.
Yes, it's okay.
So now
yes, sir.
We have
the. Sir, please repeat the last step once again.
So,
please repeat the last sentence.
So, where are you right now? In which step are you? Hello.
The previous one, sir, where we have to select all the four studies included.
So you are able to see all the studies, right? So just select all the studies.
Sir.
Select means click on the first study and press shift and press down arrow so that all the studies get selected. And then just click finish. Is it done?
Okay, sir. Got it.
Yeah. So you now have that option to enter the data, mean standard deviation total. So just enter the data for treatment and control. This is something very random I am entering.
Sir, we have to enter any data?
This is, since it is a hypothetical exercise, you can enter anything, or rather, otherwise, shall I give you? You just enter anything, it doesn't matter, because you are not, don't publish this forest plot. That is it. Yeah, enter any anything. Just, so the mean yield is what is given there. Standard deviation is the second, and total is the number of farmers surveyed. So keeping that in mind, you just enter the result, okay?
Sir, why is it that mine is coming as events and total only?
Because you have select not outcome there. While selecting the properties of the effect size, what you have selected? You have selected the other option, which is generally given for the risk ratio. So in your case, you can enter any number and just see. You just enter in the way, like if treatment is for 150 people, how many of them have benefited? So 150, and you find that 50 of them have benefited. So you enter like that.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Event means how many have benefited. That is the event. Okay.
Okay.
And
okay.
Other is the number. Okay, so just enter, and while entering itself, forest plot will be visible. You can adjust the visibility of the forest plot, how well it looks, by just dragging it this way or that way. Okay. Hope you have entered. Okay. So all are with me. And then click, just listen. So if anyone has not finished entering also, just listen here. There is an icon here called forest plot, just below this. If you click on that, you will be able to see this, and you can save that in any format you want. SVG, PDF, PNG, okay. You can save the system. And in this forest plot, we are able to see the pooled effect. This is the pooled effect, okay?
So, sir, in general, how do you have this, these figures for you to be inputted here, like the mean, the standard deviation? Where are you going to have them?
So just look in this forest plot. So here our pooled effect is 4.24. So this is the mean difference. We have selected mean difference as the effect size. So the treatment mean is higher by 4.24 if it is a yield and if it is measured in quintals. So treatment, the effect of the treatment is 4.24 quintals in comparison to the control. Okay.
So may I ask a question, please?
Yeah, sure.
So if I had on a reality case, if I had the studies that I want to do the meta-analysis with the studies, ideally in the part of adding studies, I'm supposed to remember the title of each study that I want to include in the meta-analysis, or this part where we are typing in the name of this, the title of the study. Is there a simpler way of maybe just adding a study there, or we have to type each and every study to include?
So there are two things to it. Let me do tell the easier thing first. There are many other softwares as well. The latest version of Stata 16 has inbuilt meta-analysis option. It is very simple there. You can enter the information which is in the Excel, just export into Stata, and you can do systematic review. Means you can do the meta-analysis. Okay. But as far as remembering the study ID, yeah, that is the trouble that you have to not only remembering, like once you are doing the systematic review, you have all these informations, well documented information, not only about the selected studies, but also of the studies, total number of studies, and at each step, how many studies you have excluded and why those studies were excluded, all these things. So it is a time taking process. So don't rush to a systematic review and meta-analysis just by saying, okay, I came to know how to do it in Riffman. I can do select 18 study in this area and I can do systematic review. Then you will be labeled as a bad systematic reviewer. So rather than that, it is a time-taking process. Good reviews are done by taking years. And that is the kind of effort that is required. So I am just giving you what is the process involved. So all data is hypothetical, and even if we see here, so this is not a significant result that we have got. Okay, so this is just a hypothetical result. So request you to go through good systematic review papers and all and see. Okay. As far as the easy ways are concerned, Stata is one software. Even in SPSS also it can be done. But Riffman is a very standard tool for systematic review and meta-analysis. Okay. So hope all of you have